This is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 13, ISE Applications. In this second part of the lecture, we are going to talk about knowledge mining and information extraction. And what I'm going to show to you is how we can transform simple data into knowledge, which is the process of knowledge mining, of course. Okay, let's start with a little experiment. What is this? A number, you might say. Yes, of course, this is a number. But what does the number mean? Is it a temperature? Is it a weight? Is it a length, a height? We have no idea. So I have to give you more information, otherwise you can't make sense of it. Oh, now it's connected to meters. What does that mean? It might be a height, a width. It might be a diameter. Oh yeah, it's a length. It's definitely a length. So it's not a circumference, it's a length. This is nice. But is it long? Compared to my height, of course, this would be long. Compared to, let's say, a mountain, of course, this is not long or high. So to make more sense and to understand really the meaning of that kind of data, we have to know more. We have to get more context information. I'm going to give you that. What do you say now? Now you see 33.6 meters and this is a blue whale. And you think, the blue whale. Blue whale is the largest enemy, the largest animal alive. So therefore, you know now several things. According to, I have given here a reference, and this reference states exactly that this kind of blue whale, the largest blue whale that has been measured with scientific method so far, has been 33.6 meters. Oh, if you know this, then, of course, if you experience and see a blue whale that is larger, let's say 35 meters, then this is extraordinary because, wow, you can put it now in perspective. And you also see that all other animals, they should be smaller. So this is something you can now relate. So you have this knowledge now. Of course, if we want to put this kind of knowledge together with our data in a machine, we have to use knowledge representations, and we already know how to do that. So the blue whale, I have given it here its Latin name, Balaenoptera musculus. We can say that a blue whale has a maximum length in meters of 33.6. There is no larger blue whale so far. And of course, we know that a blue whale is an animal. And with the help of description logics, we can put that together and say a blue whale is a subclass of some animal which has a maximum length of 33.6 meters. Moreover, of course, we could say, yeah, animal is kind of a thing. And of course, plants are also things. And usually, I'm not an expert, I'm not a biologist. Usually, animals and plants are two different things. So they don't have necessarily, let's say, an intersection. Of course, this might not be the case. Biologists might contradict. For the simple case, just let it be that way. However, also the statement that there was so far no blue whale larger than 33.6 meters is kind of a statement. And of course, this statement comes from a measurement which has taken place at a specific date. It was in 1922 that exactly this large blue whale was measured. And the reference that this measurement has been taken was referenced in an article in a book by Brown about the blue whale, about Balaenoptera musculus in 1995. So this is now a lot of information, and we can put the data into its perspective. So we have gained knowledge about the data. Okay. Data alone, keep this in mind, is raw. It simply exists. And it has no significance beyond its existence in and of itself. It can exist in any form, usable or not, so don't care. Data alone is more or less useless. You need to have information. Information is data that has been given meaning by way of relational connection. However, this meaning can be useful, but doesn't have to be necessarily. Information usually is contained in descriptions and answers to questions that begin with such words as who, what, when, where, how many. However, we want to know more. We want to see patterns. How do things really interact? What is useful? So we have to come up with knowledge. And in this focus or this context of definition, knowledge can be defined as an appropriate collection of information such that its intent is to be useful. So this is another kind of knowledge definition. You remember from the first part of the lecture that we also have different kind of definitions, but this is in terms of, you know, knowledge extraction. So we want to see the way how we do come from data to knowledge, and we see there is information in between. However, there is even one thing beyond knowledge. We want to know knowledge patterns. We want to understand principles of that knowledge to be able to make predictions about the future. And this then is referred to as wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to make sound judgments and decisions. So, data transforms to information by convention. Information to knowledge by cognition, and knowledge to wisdom finally by contemplation. So this is then the continuum of understanding what we are talking about here. And this can be also nicely visualized in the form of this kind of pyramid. That's the famous DIKW pyramid as drawn by Akoff in 1989. So this is the knowledge or DIKW pyramid. In the basis layer, you have data, raw characters and symbols. Then you say you have information in some kind of usable form in the way that you can relate things with each other. But it becomes only knowledge if you enrich it with semantics, so you put some meaning in there. And if you evaluate your understanding, you might finally then come to wisdom and you are able to make predictions about the future. You understand the underlying principles, you know why, you know what is best and how to do things right. So the process to transform data into knowledge is usually referred to as data or knowledge mining. And it usually starts with collecting your data. If you have your data, you have to organize it somehow. And then after organizing your data, you are able to analyze it to extract, in the end, knowledge. And the first step, how we want to do this, we want to do some kind of visual analysis here, which is, of course, summarizing organization of your data, putting it in a specific way, and then analyze it with a visual way. So you make a visualization, a picture of it, and then you can, of course, find out interesting things. Why we are doing this with a picture, I can show you with a very famous example. Probably some of you might have seen this nice infographics. It's from the 19th century by a guy named Charles Minard from 1869. And if we look closer to that, so this should be a map. So we have here west, we have on the other side here, we have east, and the map shows the Russian campaign of Napoleon Bonaparte, you know, that French emperor that who conquered almost the entire Europe in the beginning of the 19th century. And of course, this famous Russian campaign is famous because he started here with one of the largest armies the world has ever seen. Almost 500,000 men started here in the West and they went east. So you see here the brown line getting thinner and thinner. So the thickness of this line indicates the size of the army of Napoleon. And you see here several stages, Vilna, for example, Vitebsk or Smolensk, there were battles, of course. And after battles, of course, the army is getting smaller. They arrived in Moscow, and then when winter came, they went back. So they retreated. Winter is, of course, an important keyword here, because what you see down here is a temperature scale that relates to the black line. The black line here is the retreat of Napoleon. And you see how thin it gets and even thinner. And of course, Napoleon was defeated here by Russia and by the winter, because you see here temperatures. This is not a Celsius or Fahrenheit scale. This is a Réaumur scale. And here we have minus 30 degrees Réaumur. This is below minus 30 Celsius. And this is really, really, really cold. So to make sense, to answer the question why Napoleon was defeated, you simply have to put your data together, arrange it, analyze it, and then you come up with conclusions. And this can be easily done by data visualization in forms of an infographics, as you see here by that really famous info chart of Charles Minard. So, pictures are worth a thousand words, we know that. And they have been used to convey information long before the development of writing alone. A single picture can be processed and understood much faster than writing, than a text page, because in a text page, the information is ordered linearly. Your perception is processing in parallel. That means you are seeing a picture and immediately grasp its content. If you have a page of text, you have to do the sequential process of reading. And by that, your capability of text analysis, of course, is limited because you can't read a page on a single glance. Okay, therefore, we are doing information visualization to see more from the data. So information visualization is the study of sometimes interactive visual representations of abstract data to reinforce human cognition. And we have seen an example of infographics or information graphics. This is a graphic visual representation of information, data, or knowledge intended to present information quickly and clearly. So they are a static form of information visualization, and it aims to emphasize specific findings gained from the visualized data. But to do that, the first thing we have to do is, of course, data analysis. And for that, we do a quick data analysis and data visualization example. Okay, first, of course, we need a data set. We will do this with knowledge graph mining. And then we have a specific task to do with that data set. And the data set that we are dealing with here will be a data set on women soccer players. And we want to draw a map chart that visualizes the number of women soccer players per country. Okay, how do we do that? First of all, to draw a map chart, we can use online tools like, for example, Google Sheets, or we can also use Wikidata, which also enables us to do chart-based visualizations. And of course, we need the data set here to determine the number of soccer players per country. We can, of course, create a data set of women soccer players from these general huge knowledge bases, Wikidata or DBpedia, and we do this via Sparkle. So this will be our quick example. Okay, how do we start that? To get some data out of these knowledge bases, we did this already in the mid part of the lecture when we were doing Sparkle and knowledge representation. So first of all, you look up some famous example, a sample of the data you want to find. And you do this if you first start, let's say, with DBpedia, you start with Wikipedia, because in Wikipedia you find quickly what you are looking for. So here, for example, for Marta Vieira da Silva, so she's one of the most famous female football players of all times. So you can look her up at Wikipedia, and if you have then the URI of her in Wikipedia, you can directly get from there to the DBpedia URI by simply using the same suffix and adding the prefix of DBpedia there. And then if you look her up in DBpedia, I have given you here the link for that, you can find out what kind of properties, what kind of Sparkle query we might do. So I can show you this here. So we have here her Wikipedia page, and we see here interesting data. So for example, her birth date, the birthplace. We will need the birthplace then to find out about the country, of course. What's that? Brazil women's national football team. This is a birthplace, so people are born in Brazil's women's national football team. I don't think so. What does that mean? This means if we extract the data here, we have to be careful because we have to clean it up before we use it then for our further analysis. Okay, so we can use the birthplace for the country to get the information about the country. And yeah, what else? We have to find out that she's a women's soccer player. We might find out via RDF type. This is below. Here via type we might find out, yeah, she's a person, of course, and she is an agent, a natural person, she's an athlete, she's a soccer player. But we don't find out that she's female, so this is a bit more difficult. So probably we should go here via the category. So you have DCT subject, we have learned already about the category system that is transferred from Wikipedia to DBpedia. And there we find, for example, that she's some kind of FIFA Women's World Cup player, so she's kind of association football player, and we might find that out. So there is a, yeah, we see this here Women's Association football forwards. And if we look at exactly that one, Women's Association football forwards, let's go to some broader class. So we have here association football forwards. No, that's not what we are looking for. We are looking for few Women's Association football players by position, and then we have Women Association football players. This is the class we are looking at. And we use this and all classes which are below. So the classes below you find here. So you have then there Women Association football players by club, by competition, by country, by nationality. So we have to be sure to get all. So we have to go to all of the classes below Women's Association football players. This is what we are going to do. Okay, so we check for available properties as we have said here to extract the desired data, but things of course are not always straightforward, so sometimes you have to use some turnarounds to get the data that you want. Okay, so now let's put together the Sparkle query we want to have. We need the country and we need the number of women's soccer players per country. So first of all, to find out who are the women's soccer players, we said already we want to go via DCT subject to all subclasses of women's association football players. So here take care that in the name of the class women's association football players we have an apostrophe, and that the query processor gets along with it. You have to mask it here with a backslash. And we use here also let's say a rather not complicated, but already a progressed Sparkle construct. This is a property path. So the subject we are looking here should connect it via DCT subject, and then probably via another path or another link to via SCOS broader to exactly this Women's Association football players. And we make a star which indicates this might occur none at all. So it might be directly a member of Women's Association football players, or it might be any subclass. So subclass connection is here via SCOS broader, and we have a not specified number of subclasses we might look down. Okay, then we have to find out about the country. So birthplace, of course, the birthplace usually is some kind of city or village. We have to find out what's the country of the birthplace, and we have to make sure that the country really then also is a country. You remember the women's soccer team there, which is of course not a country. And we need from the country the label, and the label of course should be in English because otherwise we would have simply too many labels. And then we have to group everything by the country label to count the individual players, and this will be done by count distinct. So we know already how to create a Sparkle query. Now let's do this here, for example, in DBpedia. I have already prepared that query for you. Oh, just a second. And of course, we simply click here on Sparkle query and execute the query. And since I did this already before, this is rather quickly done by in this video because the result is already in the cache. So for you, it might take a bit longer. Be patient, simply try it out. And you see here, of course, we have here the results. Here are the countries and here are the counts. So it starts with the United States, United Kingdom, and so on. And you should be careful. You should really watch what is here in your result list because you have Scotland, you have Wales. Of course, they are countries. They belong to the UK. However, let's look a bit deeper. Lancashire. I'm sure that Lancashire has not the same status as Scotland, doesn't it? You have to take care about that. Even more, yeah. Warwickshire, Kent, Nottinghamshire. So the English, I know they are very proud, of course, of their country, but Kent, is this really a country? Or Nottinghamshire, is this a country? Or the England National Rugby Union team, I'm very sure this is not a country. Yeah, who knows who really is responsible for that? This means data cleanup is necessary, and for data cleanup, what you have to do is remove or aggregate countries that are no countries. So, for example, for Lincolnshire, don't simply skip it and throw it away. You might use the numbers you find here and add them to the UK. Then you can also probably also remove Scotland and Wales if you simply want to look at the UK there. Of course, there might also be countries that don't exist anymore. So, for example, there's the Kingdom of Denmark and also Denmark. Aggregate them, put them together, call them Denmark, and we are fine. And probably they're small. So you have to carefully look at your data and do data cleaning. And then we are there for visualization. So let's visualize. I have prepared for you a Google Sheet, and you are aware that with DBpedia, it's quite easy to export your data to a CSV file, and this can be easily read to the Google Sheet. We have directly here prepared for you. And here for the Google Sheet, what I can do is I can insert here simply a kind of chart, and it uses all the data we have here and it draws you a chart. But we don't want to have a chart. We want to have, let's say, first something like a, to make sense of the data, like a histogram, a bar chart. And you see here, yeah, there are a few countries with a high number of players and many, many countries with only a rather low number of players. And this looks like, you might remember this kind of ZIF distribution we have there. So then this is kind of a logarithmic distribution. We could visualize that whether this is really ZIF, so and this is a long tail distribution. We have to go to customize, and then the vertical axis you see here, we have to make it log scale, and then this should look like a straight line. It almost does. However, this is not what we were up for. We want to draw a map chart. So let's see what kind of charts are offered us here, and we will see a little bit down there. Here is a map chart, and we can of course color these countries a bit more nicely. So let's start with a light red, let's go over mid red, and let's end in dark red. And you see you have here an interesting visualization. It's even interactive, because if you hover over a country, you see the number of players there and the count. So you see here, for example, United States 519, and you see Portugal 7, Spain 171, France 148, and so on. And in gray, you see here some countries where we don't have any data, which means they don't either, they have no women's soccer players, or they are not registered in Wikipedia, which means in DBpedia. Okay, so these were these two infographics, and I also promised you to do this again with Wikidata. So also in Wikidata, we have prepared the query for you, a bit more complicated here. Analyze it for yourself. So besides, we also want to have here a picture and the name of the team people, and we also want to have the coordinate to visualize this on the map. Try it out. It takes a bit longer, almost 30 seconds. So therefore, we have prepared already the result for you, and this will end up here in an interactive map where you see as a red dot all the birthplaces of all of the soccer players here that are registered in Wikidata. And by hovering over one of these points, you might see then a picture of the player together with the name and also the birthplace. Okay, so these were two kind of visualizations, how we want to make use of the data and how we get the data in the end. So this is data analysis, data science stuff, and we did some kind of knowledge mining, knowledge extraction there to come up with new information, new knowledge about the data that we have extracted here from one of the huge knowledge bases. Okay, and of course, we want to go deeper into the subject in the next part of the lecture, knowledge mining and information extraction, part 2.